Welcome to our Linklaters Pensions Group podcast. I'm Anna Taylor, and I'm here with my colleague, Carly Taylor. Today, we're looking at the extent to which it is appropriate for trustees to take account of the views of the employer when they make investment decisions.
A trustee is required to act in the best interests of members and beneficiaries when investing. This is interpreted as meaning that they should act in members' best financial interests when making investment decisions. This requirement is now set out in the 2005 Occupational Pension Schemes Investment Regulations, but it has its origins in case law. In the 1984 case, Cowan and Scargill, the judge said that the trustees should act in the best interests of members. This was a case involving a disagreement between union-appointed trustees, including Arthur Scargill, and employer-appointed trustees, over a proposal to invest some of the assets of the mine workers' pension scheme in oil and gas. The union-appointed trustees said that it was not appropriate for the scheme assets to be invested in industries that compete with the British coal industry, and the matter went to court. The judge found in favour of the employer-appointed trustees and made it clear that trustees must act in members' best interests. When the purpose of the trust is to provide financial benefits for the beneficiaries, as is the case for pension schemes, the best interests of the beneficiaries are normally their best financial interests. In the case of the power of investment, the power must be exercised so as to yield the best return for the beneficiaries, judged in relation to the risks of the investment in question. But the judge also recognised that there are circumstances in which a benefit might be wider than maximising financial returns, saying that, although such circumstances are rare, there are circumstances in which arrangements which work to the financial disadvantage of a beneficiary may yet be for his benefit. Some commentators have given the principle of acting in members' best financial interests a narrow interpretation, as though looking after members' best financial interests excludes any consideration of the employer's interests. However, we think this interpretation is too narrow, and that trustees may, and in some cases should, take account of the employer's views and interests in deciding how to invest scheme assets. It's worth noting that the judge in Cowan and Scargill also looked to a number of American cases for guidance. These cases were clearly not binding in the UK, but they are interesting. One of these cases, Withers and Teachers Retirement System of the City of New York, involved an investment by trustees in New York City bonds. The trustees believed that in making the investment, they would help stave off the bankruptcy of the city. This was in the beneficiaries' interests because the city was the ultimate underwriter of the scheme, and if the city remained solvent, it could continue to support the scheme. We mention this because the judge referred to this case with some degree of approval, and this perhaps supports the suggestion that it isn't correct to interpret Cowan and Scargill too narrowly. So, from Cowan and Scargill, we can understand that trustees should make decisions having put aside their own interests and views. Powers should be exercised for the purpose for which they were given and not to accomplish any ulterior purpose. While Cowan and Scargill is a key case that sets out expressly that trustees have a duty to act in the best interests of members when investing, it is not authority for the proposition that the interests of members should be taken into account to the exclusion of all other factors.
Putting this question into a practical context, imagine a situation in which the trustees of a pension scheme now wish to invest in a competitor of the employer. The employer might be opposed to this proposal, particularly if it believes that it could harm the employer's business. If this situation arose, the trustees would need to weigh up the opposing viewpoints. Perhaps the investment in the competitor would be very profitable, and that would make it appear that the investment would be in members' best financial interests. But what if the employer could demonstrate in some way that it would also damage its business? Well, that might also have an impact on the members' financial interests. Members' incomes could be affected if the employer's business was harmed, and crucially, so could the employer covenant to the scheme. So what is in members' best financial interests is not always going to be as straightforward as what investment yields the greatest return and has an acceptable investment risk profile. There is support elsewhere in the case law for the view that trustees can, and sometimes should, take account of factors other than a narrow interpretation of what's in members' best interests. In the 1999 case of Edge and the Pensions Ombudsman, the judge said that one of the things trustees should take into account is the fact that they must be careful not to impose burdens which imperil the continuity and proper development of the employer's business or the employment of the members who work in that business. The main purpose of the scheme is not served by putting an employer out of business. While Edge was a case about the treatment of a scheme surplus, the judgment serves as a useful reminder that the purpose of a pension scheme is to provide benefits that have been promised by the employer. As the employer will, in the vast majority of cases, be responsible for meeting any deficit in scheme assets so that the promised benefits can be paid, it does not seem unreasonable to take account of the employer's views when making decisions about investments.
To give another example, we sometimes see employers keen for their scheme trustees to take on a greater amount of investment risk. Whether the trustees are willing to do so or not will depend on a number of case-specific factors. But one of the key considerations for trustees in this situation will be the strength of the employer covenant and what, if any, additional protections are being offered by the employer. This is relevant both because of the purpose of the scheme is to provide benefits promised by the employer and because it will be the employer who ultimately has to meet any shortfall in scheme assets. The pensions regulator has made clear in its code of practice number 3, funding defined benefits, that on funding questions, trustees should look at funding, scheme investments and the employer's covenant together and understand the interaction between them. It also makes sense in the context of investment decisions to look at those three aspects affecting the financial health of the scheme in the round. In the case of our example, depending on what level of risk the trustees are being asked to assume, the trustees may be able to accommodate the employer's request if they are satisfied that the rest of the picture, the employer's covenant and overall scheme funding, are sufficient to make up any gap if the additional risk results in additional losses.
There has been one more recent case on this subject that helps clarify things further. In Merchant Navy Ratings Pension Fund Trustees and Stenaline Limited and others, the court considered a dispute as to whether the exercise by trustees of a unilateral power to amend the scheme rules to make former employers liable for some of the scheme's deficit was appropriate. The judge in this case made it very clear that the purpose of the trust, that is, to provide retirement benefits in accordance with its rules, and the members' best interests were essentially the same thing. The duty to act in members' best interests was not a standalone duty, but flows from and is defined by the purpose of the trust. As the purpose of a pension scheme is to provide pension benefits, it is in the members' best interests that the trustees act in a way that promotes that purpose. That does not mean that the trustees should look at their duty in relation to investments in isolation, but rather that trustees should consider whether the investment decision they wish to make is consistent with that purpose. On this point, the judge said that if the purpose of the scheme was being furthered, and assuming that the employer covenant was strong enough to support that purpose, it was reasonable and proper, should the trustee consider it appropriate to do so, to take into account the employer's interests. Helpfully, the judge also clarified that the judgment in Edge meant that it was legitimate for trustees to consider the interests of the employer and that they could act to promote the employer's continued viability.
The last point to make is that, in addition to the line of cases that assist trustees on this point, the Law Commission report on the fiduciary duties of investment intermediaries gives us a very clear steer on this point. While the legislation contains no requirement for trustees to take the employer's views into consideration, the Law Commission's view was that the employer's obligation to fund the scheme is relevant. The Law Commission view the duty to act in members' best interest as a shorthand for a bundle of duties, including the duty to promote the purpose for which the trust was created, the duty to comply with the relevant legislation, and the duty to exercise their own discretion. Again, this is consistent with a broader interpretation of the obligation to act in members' best interests and the MNRPF judgment. In most cases, where the employer is expressing a view on a proposed investment decision, any resulting request from the employer for the trustees to make a particular investment decision will have a potential financial impact on the scheme. As such, the trustees should look at the employer's covenant and the investment risk in the round. We would suggest that where what the employer is suggesting isn't likely to have a material a materially detrimental financial impact, then the trustees may wish to start from asking the question of whether there is any reason not to do what the employer requests. The employer has a clear interest in the success of the scheme, and so arguably a proposal that supports the employer's success ought also to be of benefit to the scheme. If the employer's proposal is financially neutral, taking account of the employer's own covenant to the scheme, it's hard to see why trustees would not take account of the employer's view.
Concludes the podcast. Please get in touch with your usual Linklaters contact if you have any queries or would like to discuss. For other podcasts that you might like, please visit linklaters.com or our pensions group page on LinkedIn. Thank you for listening.